Okay, guys, we're in episode number two. And the last time in episode one, I was being pelted by a snowball. Well, guess what? Payback today in episode number two.
What are you gonna do, Goose?
I'm gonna let old John Mendenhall have it.
Oh, batter up!
Well, oh, Brian.
It wasn't much of a threat, but it was a good pitch.
That's right. All right, so now, John, we're gonna go over here to the snow, and what do we got here in your hand?
This is the official measuring device that we use. It's a ruler that is in hundredths of an inch, tenths of an inch, and 1 foot. And this is how we measure the snow. And this ruler is used to measure the snow and the water content. And we have a place right over here at this place that we measure the snow on a daily basis and report how much snow is left on the ground. So let's go do it.
All right.
Now, doesn't it have to have a level spot so you get an accurate reading?
You want a level spot. You want a place that is somewhat protected, but not underneath a tree. You can see that the snow under the tree is gone.
Definitely.
It didn't hit the ground. We don't want it in a place where it might pile up or drift. So we find a nice place, and here we've put a board underneath the snow before it started to snow, and so now we can go down and hit the board and find out how many inches are left.
Left, okay.
And so we stick this down in the snow. You can see we've done this a number of times. And right there, that looks like we are at 2.5 inches. That's tenths of an inch.
All right,
of snow.
So how much water would be in that?
That we would have to melt it and to find out.
Oh.
Or weigh it. We know how much water weighs, so we can weigh it and find out that way.
Okay, so now we got a measuring device out back, right?
We have a precipitation device out here out back, and we'll go take a look at that.
Okay.
This is the official weather site of the Spanish Fork Powerhouse. This is a thermistor that measures the temperature and reports it inside to an instrument that we have that records the high and low temperatures of the day. This is designed specifically to kind of be shaded, but not in the shade all day long. So again, we want an open place. This is called the snow can or the precipitation can. It's a specific diameter, and it is used so that the water or snow that falls in here goes to the bottom and fills up. And again, we use our
batting stick.
Our batting stick.
Okay.
We stick down in there, and we have not had any precipitation today. Although we've got clouds, we've had no precip. If there was any precip, this has a mica finish to it that would show the watermark, and that would show how many inches of moisture we've had in that 24-hour period, whether it be snow or water. If it's cold enough that it stays snow, we have to warm that up and melt the snow. 2 weeks ago, we had an extremely high amount of water here at the power plant, and we had 1.97 inches of moisture in one 24-hour period.
I
on a Saturday
that.
Night, Sunday morning,
I remember that.
We had 1.97. That was almost 2 full inches of water in that snow.
Now, there's probably some people in our viewing audience that's really worried about the watershed and if we're gonna have enough drinking water this summer. What would you tell the people?
It's always a concern, Goose, and we have had ups and downs this year. We started the year out really, really low. October and November were extremely low. If you remember, December, we had a great month, and we brought our averages up to around 100%. Just after the first of the year, it went dry again, and we fell about 20% down into the 80 percentile. 2 weeks ago, when we had that high moisture content storm, it came up to 100% again. Now, it's been 2 weeks since we had our last storm, and that percentage has fallen again down into the low 80s. But that happens on a regular basis here in Utah. We don't get storms on a real consistent basis. They come and then they're gone. And so this weekend, we expect to see that snow average go up again near 100% with the storm that's coming in.
All righty. Now, we have a lot of young viewers out there that watch our show. if they're interested in weather forecasting and that, what would you recommend a young kid do?
Well, the best thing that a young kid can do is to go to school and learn a little bit about climatology. Here, we just collect the information, but if you really want to have a lot to do with climate and the weather, you'd want to study about that and get a formal education in climatology and to learn those things. It's really an interesting profession because there are so many factors that go into the weather forecasting. Here, we just observe it. We don't forecast it.
All right. And so, if you've got some interest in climatology, snow, rain, and things of that nature, make sure you get good grades in school, right?
Absolutely. Get the grades in school, find yourself a little higher education, and make some money at it.
And maybe you can be another Kevin or a Mark Eubank. Right, Bryce?
Yeah, you can.
All right.
I call him Mark Snowbank and Kevin Snowbank. Is that all right?
That's absolutely
fine. That's
all
right, because we're writing a snowbank right now.
Absolutely.
All right. We'll be back in just a minute. Bryce, what's really interesting? How we look around the base of this tree, and there is no snow.
Yeah, it is interesting.
John, why is that?
Well, there's two reasons for that. One is that the ground is somewhat shielded from the snow by the limbs that come down here, so the snow isn't as deep. But once that there's a spot in the snow that goes bare, the sun hits that spot and the solar radiation warms that area and melts the snow back. And so you can see right underneath this tree there's no snow, and as you look out into the snow there, you can see where the grass is beginning to pop through. There's bigger and bigger spaces that are starting to melt off, and that's true in the mountains or anywhere else. Once there's a rock or a blade of grass or a tree that sticks up through, that's where the snow melts first.
So solar energy.
Solar energy.
Over at Salem Hills High, we use some ice melt, some chemical melters, de-icers. But we got one right in the sky, right?
The biggest snow melter of all.
Beautiful.
Love it. That's right, the sun.
Guess what? We're going to go right over here and we got a little surprise for you.
Head out on the highway, looking for adventure, and whatever comes our way.
Oh,
oh
no.
No!
Oops!
Oops! Way. Get readings?
Yes. We used to go up into Strawberry Valley and go up there on snowshoes or on snowmobiles and go in and stick a tube into the snow, bring it out, weigh it to find out how much water was in it and actually measure the depth. But now these are automated stations that will give us all of that information on an hourly basis.
They can go right here in
right
the comfort here of their home.
Absolutely.
No snowshoes.
No snowshoes. No,
no gloves. No snowmobiles.
No snowmobiles.
What's the fun in that?
Yeah.
Well, it's a lot warmer and drier.
Oh, all right.
I have this this site that is the NRCS, the National Resource Conservation Service. There is the website right there, the nrcs.usda.gov. Snowtell, Utah, and that will bring this up. This is an interactive map. The Spanish Fork River drainage is a drainage that is about 680 square miles, and we have a number of snowtell stations which pertain to the Spanish Fork drainage. This one is Payson Ranger Station in Payson Canyon. These two are up on Skyline Drive, and Clear Creek 1 is one that we like to look at a lot. And if we click on that site,
It will come up. We don't have the advantage of having Spanish Fork cable here that gives us the extremely fast internet. This is a picture of this actual site that is up there. This is Clear Creek number one. It gives us the number, the latitude, longitude, and the elevation. This one is at nearly 9,000 feet. It's at 8,908 feet. Here you've got what they have at this station. And if we click on snow depth in the last 7 days, and this is on hourly, it will give us an hourly readout of how much snow, the depth in inches, we have at that site. As you'll see, this is 7 days ago. This is on the 30th. And as we go down through that, we'll come to the day today. Here we are on the 5th at 3 o'clock this afternoon. It will update very soon to the 4 o'clock reading. Snow water equivalent is the amount of water that's in the snow, and we have 11.3 inches of water. We have 42 inches of snow. That's in depth. The year-to-date precipitation, the amount of water we have had at this site since October 1st, is 14.1 inches. The temperature right now up there is 32.4. We had a maximum temperature of 43.9, a minimum of 27.3, for an average of the day of 33.1. And you can pick up any station that is in our area or anywhere else in the state and get that information.
Oh, that's cool.
It's cold, Goose. It's ice.
Oh, it's cold. Yeah, see that?
Yeah.
See, we got another witty guy here. Witty.
Goose on the snowmobile.
Goose on the fly.
That's just dangerous. Well, thanks, John.
You're welcome.
Okay, we're down here at Healy Plumbing. Probably a lot of you people know our guest. It's Paul Healy, good friend of mine. Played a lot of softball together and against each other. And he's going to be on our show today. He's got a 1952 Ford tractor. Right, Paul?
Golden Jubilee.
Welcome to our show, man. Appreciate you. Now, we've melted snow, we've colored snow, we've pushed snow. Now, Paul has got the blade on the back of the tractor. Now, why is it there, Paul?
Well, the tractor has a three-point hookup on it. And this is a natural thing. You don't just move snow, you move dirt. This will move about a wheelbarrow of dirt on a scoop, you know. But it works really good for snow.
Now, is this what they used in the older days?
Well, this is, they still use this today.
Oh, do they?
Yeah, they still use this crap today. It's still the same.
Now, can you put the blade on an angle?
You can put it on an angle. You can turn around backwards and actually push with it, too, if you want to.
Oh.
The thing I like about this in the snow is you can pull right up to a door or a car in a carport or something and just pull it away.
Okay.
And you don't have to...
You don't have that after that grace period, that little
right,
space there.
Where the tractor or the four-wheeler, whatever you're using, can't get to it without pushing it sideways or whatever you got.
Now, we want to tell our viewers, how much money have you got in this? You've restored it, right?
Gosh, I don't know, George.
You don't know.
I bought this tractor from Paul Beck's wife. Paul Beck, you probably know him. He's
on
the golf course.
Oh, yeah.
His wife's dad died, and I bought it in Fairview, I don't know, 15 years ago, 10 years ago. I don't remember now. And then it didn't run very good at burn oil, so I rebuilt it and put all new stuff in it.
Let's take a look down here. Bryce, come down here and take a look at the engine. Now, is this a four-popper?
Yeah, it's a four-banger.
A four-banger.
Yeah.
Okay. That's a term we haven't heard in a long time, Bryce.
No.
A four-banger.
Not since my gang years.
Oh, that's four guys in a gang?
That's right.
Okay. All right.
The thing that made this tractor a little better than the older ones, it had live power takeoff.
What does that mean?
Well, I can show you probably better than I can...
Okay.
All right.
Oh, wow. A real demonstration, Goose.
Yeah.
The old Ford tractor, you had to have the clutch out for the power takeoff to work. And the newer one, you know, the clutch is out right now. You lift that up, see that goes up. You can have the clutch in, still have it do its thing.
Well, we appreciate you being on our show.
You bet. Anytime.
As you can see, snow can be pulled, and even on this old tractor, it can be pushed. Now, what do you think? I know the Heelys have always been into boxers. Why do you love the breed?
Because they're so dang friendly.
Friendly,
and they're just fun to be around. This dog is old. He's 10 years old. But he's a good old boy.
And you've always had boxers.
Always had boxers.
When I think of the Heelys, I think of boxers, Bryce.
And boxers being dogs.
And boxers being dogs.
Yeah.
You're right.
Yep.
Well, we're going to move up to our next location and close our show. And we just appreciate Paul cluing us in on this old 52 Ford tractor.
It's called a Golden Jubilee.
The Golden Jubilee.
That's nice.
Appreciate you, man. Thanks again.
See ya.
Yep. Okay, guys, we're going to close our second episode right now. And usually, Bryce is looking for me, but we're going to turn the tables on him.
What do you mean?
You know when you had me do 10 drug-free push-ups?
Yeah.
In my kitchen?
Yeah.
Well, I'm going to turn the tables on you, and it's payback time today, baby.
You mean you're not going to go try to hide from me?
No, you're going to be doing a snow angel.
Oh, no, I'm not.
You watch this,
no
baby.
Way.
Here we go.
No, I'm not going. Goose, I'm not. Oh, Goose, hey, we dropped the camera, man. Goose, I'm not going to do it. I'm not going to do it.
Get down in here, baby.
You can't make me.
Get down in here.
How are you gonna make me?
Get down in here.
You're like, ah! How are you gonna make me do the snow angel?
Snow angel, baby.